Thank you. We got Justin Warfield. Thank you for taking the time today to chat with us a little bit. We've had you in Movement Magazine back in 2006 and 2007, and we're excited to be able to talk to you today about what's going on with She Wants Revenge and your upcoming show in Orlando. So, how are you doing?
Thanks for having me. I'm really good. Thank you.
Where are you at right now?
I am. This is the exciting world of touring. I am behind a Barnes & Noble in suburban Atlanta on a sort of travel day that would have been too far of a drive to go from New Orleans to Durham, North Carolina. Oh. So it's like one of the fun things about touring is you're like, okay, 16-hour drive. What do we want to do? It's like, well, why don't we stop somewhere in between? So I'm also the tour manager. So I was like, all right, let's do Atlanta. So you get a little culture, you get some coffee, watch a movie, take care of life stuff on a day off. And then tomorrow back to the Rock in Durham, NC.
Nice. Atlanta is a fantastic city to do that in. Good choice.
Yeah. You know, I just, I like the road lifestyle. It's not for everybody, but I really enjoy it. You have to sort of be built a certain way to withstand it. And I function well in road situations.
Nice. Man, this is the last time, I think way back when we featured you and stuff, since then, that sort of the sort of post-punk dark wave scene has really sort of blown up. There's been a lot of bands. That sort of that sound you guys started up again, sort of imitated and gone on and created a whole bigger and better scene for it. So have you seen any acts lately that you enjoy?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, like the way you phrased it, like, it, you know, I feel like I see what happens. Adam sees even more so because he's been more plugged into the scene and the music, both as a DJ, as someone that does, you know, clubs, and as somebody that probably spends more time, you know, listening to that sort of style of music because of he's a DJ and just as he chooses to as an artist and as a music listener. So over the years, I've seen the scene develop. I mean, the way I look at it is this, like, I think that there's really cool artists out there. Like the ones that I really dig are like, I like Softkill and they're friends of ours. I like Soft Moon a lot. I discovered him just through like, I feel like it might've been like either online, it was something online, maybe even like a skateboard video or something, but I really like him a lot. I think it's really interesting what sort of, what Boy Harsher and Drab have done at a sort of large level impacting that culture. And the way I look at it is like this, man, like dark music takes lots of forms, whether you're talking about like, you know, Typo Negative is dark music, right? But it's incredibly heavy. And also like, you know, fill in the blank, like, you know, Bauhaus is dark music, but there's no real connective tissue there. I think that what unites them might be that in a society or in a culture, there is a possibility that the person who goes to both concerts or listens to both records might be the same person more likely than the person who's listening to, say, you know, Black Moth Super Rainbow or Demi Lovato or any other group. I think that there is, people are drawn to darker things culturally. And like, yeah, people want to put labels on it like dark wave or goth, but like, except for like to me, goth has always been a fan generated term. I don't know any artist, and I don't mean this derisively, but it's going to come off that way. But I don't know any artist who's actually an originator from back in the day, not somebody who's like done it recently, but I don't know any artists from back in the day who are considered the architects of that culture. No artist worth their salt has ever called their music goth. Like in that scene, like, look, if you might, there might be somebody who came in second or third wave and did it really well and calls it, but having had conversations, shared the stage with, shared moments and space with, I can tell you firsthand that the people who are considered like the originators of goth music do not call it that. And neither do we. And so I think this is a long-winded way of saying that, like, I'm in Atlanta. If I see somebody in a My Bloody Valentine shirt, there's a possibility that person also might like New Order. And they're probably going to like New Order more than they are like Sabbath, or more than they are like, you know, Autechre or something, because there's like a connective tissue. So when you say something like the dark wave scene, I think that what's great is that the same way there was always like something super one way like Thrill Kill Cult and something super one way like Sisters, there's actually nothing musically connecting those groups, right? Except for the same type of person might go to both shows. And so I think that right now in the culture, you look at groups like Soft Kill, Soft Moon, Drab, Boy Harsher, it's a healthy scene and fans have a lot to choose from, and artists are expressing themselves and starting bands nowadays and using darker means of making music and not doing things in a bright, sunshiny way. I think that's great and it fulfills the need. And I think that we all probably listen to the same source material growing up. The difference with us is, you know, I'm turning 50 this year. You know what I mean? And Adam's already, what's that?
Welcome to the club.
Thank you. And Adam's already in his early 50s. So like culturally, we're not of the same generation of any of the artists that I mentioned, whether you're talking about Bauhaus or whether you're talking about Drab and Boy Harsher. So like we consider ourselves like, I mean, and I don't really give a shit if artists consider us or not, we're sort of the godfathers of that wave that came after, because really there was always hardcore core groups doing music, whether it was on labels like Cleopatra or super niche or super underground. But the truth is, the difference between us and them, meaning the hardcore niche groups that were really, really dark, is we always considered ourselves a group that was more influenced by like Depeche Mode and Prince and New Order than we did Sisters, Bauhaus, or Joy Division. We took inspiration from Suicide and Depeche Mode and Prince and Sonic Youth and, you know, shoegaze. And we put it all together in a pot as men of a certain age making music. And we wrote songs. And because we wrote songs with hooks, with lyrics that connected in a way like I saw previously happen with audiences with Robert Smith or with Morrissey or with Brian Malko and Placebo, heartfelt lyrics that weren't pretentious, that weren't trying to be esoteric for esoteric sake or mystical or weird, that were telling stories that were relatable with music that you could dance to and that was dark and that made you feel a certain kind of way. And we did that in a way that was pretty big and pretty big in scope with big hooks and really, really, really mining influences as two producers and DJs who grew up listening to this shit in the 80s, not third generation, fourth generation permutations, a sample of a copy of a copy. So we did it. And then we were recognized by the artists that we were influenced by and like, co-headlined the tour with Peter Murphy, like played festivals with The Cure, open for Depeche Mode. So I think it's very safe to say that even though we came along in the mid-aughts amidst the post-punk revival, we had less in common with our contemporaries who at the time were, I'm not saying that we were in as big as them, but we played shows alongside Block Party and The Killers and Bravery and Interpol and all of those bands, right? And there was a lot more. There was Louis the 14th. There was a lot of things, right? And like, people called it this like dance punk thing. And to be honest, like, the people that started that wave was the Faint. The Faint was doing it first. Faint were indie rockers from Omaha, Nebraska, who were like, let's put down our guitars and pick up synths.
Oh yeah.
I was playing, we were spinning Faint records as DJs before any of those other bands I mentioned were even picking up synthesizers.
And I put them on the magazine in 2000.
Yeah, dude, like, the Faint don't get enough credit. They did it. Yep. They kicked open the door. And then I saw what the Rapture was doing, which to me was like a very like skronky no wave take on The Cure. And I thought that was amazing. And we were like, well, no one's really doing stuff that feels like Black Celebration or, you know, Violator meets like Prince and Giorgio Moroder. And we did our thing. So is there a scene? Yes, the scene is healthy. I don't think those groups are influenced by us, but I think those groups benefited from the work that we did to remind people, both of our age generation and younger, that there was a scene to be had, that there was something. And it didn't have to be niche. It didn't have to be in a club basement with 75 people united by like KMFDM shirts and like wearing all black. That it could be mainstream on a festival stage, on MTV, on the radio, on Sirius, with hits, with bangers in a club. And we were fortunate to write a song that became an evergreen sort of staple of that scene. And so now when you think of a dark playlist and you go, okay, well, you know, Every Day is Halloween, Love Will Tear Us Apart, Bela Lugosi's Dead, you know, Tear You Apart. That's incredible that we're a part of that. So we feel like a little bit like the older uncles or godfathers of a certain scene. But at the same time, there's a lot of groups that have no musical connection to us other than the fact that we came before. And like, what I'm talking about is lineage. We just did a tour where the Chameleons came out with us, which was incredible. And we had this conversation and he said, man, we're all links in a chain. And so that's what it really is, right? We're all links in a chain. So I don't feel like these groups were influenced by us, but I think they benefited from the work that we did before, just like we benefited from the work that those groups I mentioned and 100 more came up with. What I'm really excited about in the scene right now is that there's a resurgence of shoegaze and a dark sort of shoegaze. So I think that groups like Dive that came out after us, who were really doing this really sort of indie take on sort of a Cure-esque sort of early Cure thing, that now there's bands like Julie and Bedroom and all these amazing shoegaze bands that are younger and doing incredible music. And that really makes me happy because that's always been a huge part of our thing. I mean, I was probably more influenced by My Bloody Valentine and Ride and, you know, that.
Yeah.
Actually, Slow Dive, I'm newer to. I knew who they were back in the day and had heard some of Souvlaki, but shockingly enough, it's like, I really missed a lot of Slow Dive and there was a lot of stuff that I did catch in real time back then. So my Slow Dive education has come very, very recently. And I went back and really dove deep and I really, really connect to it.
Good stuff. So let me get to the current tour. I guess you guys are out there now. What can we expect on Thursday in Orlando? Are you guys going to be doing obviously the classics, but you're doing some of the newer stuff? Are you guys writing anything or doing any studio work?
Yeah.
What's happening with the band?
Well, starting with the last part of the question, we are going to be doing studio stuff. When we finish the tour in the middle of December, we're going home. We're going to do little holidays separately and live our lives. And then we're going to jump into the studio and start writing a new album. And we haven't written an album, as you probably know, in over a decade. We've done a couple of songs. And so we've only done three albums.
2011, right?
What's that?
2011 was the last one?
Last album? So we're going to be following up Valley Heart with a new album. I mean, we were working on a new album like when the pandemic hit, and we're not really going to go back to those songs. It's nice that we have songs that are like sort of in the canon of like archival stuff, but I think we're going to just start from scratch, and Adam and I are going to start writing songs. And now the band is a 5-piece live, and I think we're going to probably incorporate a lot more live music in the process. We have a lot of things that we've been talking about how we want to record and what we want the music to be like. Being on the road for 5 months has really helped us figure out what we want to do live, and then that will inform what we want to do in the studio, what kind of band we are now. And being on the road is great. What you can expect at the show is we're playing sort of songs from all the eras, really. I mean, you know, it really covers the entire sort of spectrum of what we do. We just present it in a much heavier way now. And I don't mean that like distortion, but I mean, it's definitely like, we always played with the intention of having it be very, very close to the record and very tight and sort of precise. And I think that we just wanted to like infuse it with a bit of juice and pump up what we're doing a little bit. So I think the beats slap a little bit more. The drums are heavier. The rhythm section is heavier, which in turn makes the band heavier. It's like Wet Leg, right, is one of my favorite bands right now. And like Wet Leg, it made a really great record. It's really cool. It's really poppy. It's very smart. But when I saw them live, I was blown away because it was just super heavy in like a fuzz and sort of drums way. And in that same token, I think people who saw us in the past or who've never seen us are going to say like, wow, this is a pretty powerful live band. And that's what's exciting about our live show and what in turn will inform the album.
I'm super excited about it.
And the other cool thing is just like, ultimately, like for fans of the band or people who care, I think the problem with us, for people who are committed to what we do musically and believe in what we do and follow our journey, is that they care a lot about what we do. And it's been a bit of faucet on, faucet off, where the band breaks up and gets back together. And like, I mean, the sort of elephant in the room for any She Wants Revenge fan is like, either, oh my God, I love you guys, but I was too young to ever see you play. And then by the time I wanted to see you play and I discovered you from fill in the blank, this movie, this TV show, this algorithm, right? They're like, oh, then I heard you guys broke up. And so we're just in a place where we really are getting along very well. It's not a like band-aid of like, we've made up and we're gonna like make music. It's like, I think we've both accepted the fact that what we do together is special. What we do separate is very special. What we do together is very special. It's very rare. We're very fortunate to have the ability to travel the world, because since we got back together, we have quite literally traveled like all over Europe, the UK, and North America. And we'll continue to do other parts of the world, including Asia and South America, like in the years that follow. But we get to tour the world doing what we do in front of quite often sold out audiences that love what we do. And that's like an amazing gift. And whatever we have to do to coexist as friends, as musicians, as artists, serving this thing that we created together, whatever we have to do to find a way to not only do it, but enjoy it and do it sort of with love for each other and the music and the fans, that's sort of the work. Because writing songs is easy, performing songs is easy. Keeping a marriage together of, you know, two creative individuals who are over the 15-year mark now, that's the hard work. But I think that we both were like, we just have to do it, because the music, the fans, and our own ability to participate in something as dope as it deserves it.
All right, well, I'm gonna wrap it up. I want to get this online so we can see you on Thursday, and I definitely appreciate you taking the time for us.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man. Hope I get to see you. Come say hi to Adam and I.
Absolutely.